Hello, everybody. Welcome back to my channel, and thank you for joining me for another true crime deep dive. Today, we are continuing on with the case of Anne Marie Fahey, and this is part two. So if you haven't seen part one yet, it is linked in the description box, and you should probably watch that first, or none of this will make any sense. Now, before we dive in, let's have a word from the sponsor of today's video, Surfshark VPN. Surfshark is a modern VPN designed with the user in mind. Their utilities are powered by robust security mechanisms, but they're designed to be simple and intuitive to use. So basically, Surfshark VPN does a lot, but you don't have to do a lot. And if somebody like me, who is incredibly technologically challenged and has used a lot of VPNs in my time that I've had trouble with and I've struggled with, I can promise you that Surfshark VPN is by far the easiest to navigate, and their interface is the most intuitive to use. Surfshark VPN is a solid and feature-packed service that is far beyond other VPNs, in my opinion, when it comes to speed, security, and features. If you're not using a VPN, you really should be. Surfshark encrypts all the data sent via the internet, and that means they're protecting your passwords, your private messages, your photos, videos, and other sensitive data from prying eyes. With Surfshark's camouflage mode, you can stay private. Even your internet provider can't tell that you're using a VPN, which means they can't throttle your speed while streaming or gaming, which they have been known to do. Take it from me, a gamer. It is the most frustrating thing when you pay all this money for Wi-Fi and internet, and then you can't even use it. It also keeps you protected from advertisers. You know, the ones who watch everything you're doing online so they can hit you with targeted ads. Like, if you've ever wondered why it seems that Facebook can read your mind or Instagram can read your mind, almost like they knew you were shopping for that new Oculus 2 VR headset, and now every time you sign into Facebook or Instagram, you see an ad for the new Oculus. You know, they aren't reading your mind, they're just stalking you on the internet. And if you turn on Surfshark's clean web feature, you can surf in a cyber ocean with no ads, trackers, malware, or phishing attempts. And let me tell you, that's nice. It feels like during this pandemic, there have been an uptick in scam attempts. So keep yourself protected with Surfshark VPN. But my favorite Surfshark VPN feature is open borders mode. I'm sure you've run into this before. You know, you're trying to watch a YouTube video and you get this message like, sorry, this content isn't available in your area. This is called geo-blocking, and that's where certain websites, because they know your location, they block you from certain areas of the internet, and it sucks. Surfshark believes the internet should be open for everyone, so they give you the ability to change your virtual location. This way you can access all your favorite content no matter where you are. I use this feature a lot with like Netflix and streaming services if I want to watch a show that's either not available in the United States or hasn't been released yet in the United States. I also use it when I want to watch a college basketball game that's been blacked out in my area for some reason. Surfshark VPN really has the ease of use, the value, and the features. And right now, for a limited time, you can get 83% off a two-year plan and 3 extra months for free at surfshark.deals/StephanieHarlowe. This special offer makes your subscription just $2.21 a month, and you can use Surfshark VPN on unlimited devices, which is amazing. So your phone, your husband's computer, your kid's laptops, your mom's tablet, your grandmother's tablet, every device protected, unlimited. Once again, go to surfshark.deals/StephanieHarlowe. There's an E on the end of Stephanie and Harlow, and you will get 83% off a two-year plan plus 3 extra months for free. Thank you so much to Surfshark for sponsoring today's video, and let's dive in. On the evening of Saturday, June 29th, 1996, five people gathered in the third floor walk-up apartment of 30-year-old Anne Marie Fahey. They were searching for clues on where the normally reliable and orderly young woman could be. Anne Marie's boyfriend, Mike Scanlon, and her sister, Kathleen, had already discovered several clues that led them to believe she had not left of her own free will. Anne Marie was known to keep her apartment in an immaculate condition, yet they had found groceries sitting on the counter and spoiled food rotting in the garbage can. In her bedroom, the unmade bed, haphazard closet, and presence of suitcases only reinforced their belief that Anne Marie had not gone off for a weekend trip. The other three people present were two of Anne-Marie's friends and co-workers, Jill Morrison, who had started working at the governor's office around the same time as Anne-Marie, Ginny Columbus, another friend of Anne-Marie's from the governor's office, and Ginny's mother, Virginia. But notably absent were the police, even though Kathleen had already reported her sister missing to the Wilmington Police Department. Kathleen said after calling the police and having them not show up, she waited for what felt like forever. And then she called an old family friend of the Faheys, Ed Friel, who had one time acted as Governor Carper's chief of staff, but at the time of Anne-Marie's disappearance, he was working as the Secretary of State. Ed was having dinner that evening at the Irish pub that his family owned downtown. This pub was called O'Friel's, and Ed was in the company of his wife Maureen and his brother Bud, who had actually at one time been Kathleen Fahey's boyfriend. So Kathleen told Ed Friel that no one had seen Anne-Marie in 3 days, and she'd called the police, but they still hadn't shown up. So Ed hung up and called Karen Johnson, who at that time was the director of Delaware's Department of Public Safety, and he asked her to send some police to Anne-Marie's apartment immediately. Within minutes of Kathleen's call to Ed Friel, veteran detective Mark Daniels was on his way to Anne-Marie's apartment. We have to talk about another important player in this story. Her name was Kim Horstman. Kim and Anne-Marie had been best friends since the summer they had met at the Jersey Shore. It was a tradition for Anne-Marie and her closest friends every summer to put their money together and rent a beach house in Stone Harbor, where they could escape the heat of the city on weekends. Kim was one of the few people that Anne-Marie told everything to, and she was one of the few individuals who was aware of the relationship between her friend Anne-Marie and the hotshot Wilmington attorney Thomas Capano. Kim knew that Tom treated Anne-Marie like a princess and that he took her out to fancy dinners and gave her money and presented her with very expensive gifts, usually clothes, that Anne-Marie coveted but could not afford. Tom had also once given Anne-Marie a television as a gift. Now, when Tom had become aware of how much Kim Horstman knew about his relationship with Anne-Marie, he had asked Anne-Marie to get the three of them all together so he could meet Kim. And from that point on, Kim was sort of pulled into this secret relationship, and she became a confidant not only to Anne-Marie, but to Thomas Capano as well. It's funny how one day can change everything. You can be on a path in life. You can be going in a certain direction. You could even think you have everything planned out. But one day, one night, can change your path, can alter your path forever. And I always think, if only Anne-Marie Fahey had stayed home on the evening of April 26th, 1993. If only she'd been too tired from a long work week, and she wanted to get in bed early. But instead, she and her friend and coworker Jill Morrison attended a fundraiser for the Women's Democratic Club at the home of Jim and Mary Alice Thomas. These are big-time Democratic contributors. Like, they always give a lot of money to the Democratic Party. While they were there, Anne-Marie and Jill, they hung back. They listened to the speakers and they sipped glasses of wine. But then Anne-Marie spotted a stately older man making his way through the crowd, shaking hands, laughing, just dazzling everybody with his magnetic personality. It was Thomas Capano, and Anne-Marie made a point to pull Jill over to where Tom was so that they could introduce themselves. From that night on, whenever Tom had to stop in at Governor Carper's office, he could be found chatting with Anne-Marie at her desk. For Anne-Marie, it wasn't necessarily Capano's looks that drew her to him. It wasn't his money or his intelligence, although I'm sure all of these things were factors. But she loved that when she was with him, she felt like the only person in the world. He made her feel like the only person in the world. He gave her his full attention. He asked questions about her life, her past, her family. He asked a lot of questions. It seemed like he wanted to know every minute detail about what made Anne-Marie Fahey Anne-Marie Fahey. And as somebody who had lost her mother when she was young, as somebody who had lost her father to alcoholism, that kind of attention, that kind of almost pride, it's going to be invaluable. In March of 1994, Tom had made the offer to Anne-Marie that if she wanted to be his secret girlfriend, he would pay for her to have her own place instead of her living with two of her girlfriends, because these two girlfriends were never too happy when Tom dropped by for one of his many visits. And they thought it was weird that this older married guy was hanging out with this young single woman in her apartment alone drinking wine. Being a smart guy, being an astute guy, I'm sure he picked up on that. Now, Anne Marie did think about the proposal, but in the end, she turned it down. She had been friends with the women she lived with for years, and they were all renting a beach house in Sea Isle at the shore that summer. It was already planned, and for now, she sort of just wanted things to stay as they were. She was also very religious. She was raised in an Irish Catholic family. She went to Mass every Sunday growing up. She went to Mass every Sunday as an adult, and so she had a big problem morally with being somebody who would come between a husband and wife. When she said no to his offer, Tom, he didn't get angry or push back. He told her he understood. All he wanted was for her to just be happy. And he did this by paying attention to the things she said and anticipating her needs. A few months later, in spring, Anne Marie had to attend a wedding, and she'd gone shopping with Jill at Talbot's. While there, Anne Marie tried on a beautiful peach linen dress, but when she saw the price tag, she knew she couldn't afford it. She must have mentioned her desire for that peach linen dress to Tom, because when she attended that wedding, she was a vision in peach linen, a gift from her boyfriend, Tomas. But then on April 26th, Tom dropped a bomb on her. He told her that they had to stop seeing each other so that Anne Marie had a chance to find someone who would be able to share her life with her, someone like her sister's husband. This threw Anne Marie into a crushing, broken-hearted depression for 2 days before her boyfriend called her back and told her, "You know, I changed my mind. I can't live without you. I need to keep seeing you." And then Tom Capano jumped on a plane with his secret lover of over a decade and flew to Montreal for a law school conference. Now, according to Debbie McIntyre, the 2 days that she spent with Tom in Montreal were bliss. She had never had Tom to herself for more than a few hours. In all their years of seeing each other, they'd never gone away on a trip before. But on the flight home, Tom made her sit away from him on the plane, telling her he didn't want someone that they might know to see them together. And when they landed in Philadelphia, he took her to dinner at the Ristorante Panorama. But on the drive back to Wilmington, Debbie realized she'd forgotten her purse under the table at the restaurant, and they had to turn around to retrieve it, which Tom was not happy about. He raged at her. He said, "How could you be so stupid? How could you do such a stupid thing and leave your purse behind? You're an idiot." And he complained about the time that they were wasting because of her. Later, Debbie, recalling that night, said, quote, "I apologized profusely. By that point in our relationship, I was constantly apologizing to him about something. I was sorry, sorry, sorry. I was sorry for things I didn't even need to be sorry for, and I was probably getting on his nerves. He made me feel like such an idiot. He was so verbally abusive that night." End quote. If only Anne Marie Fahey could have been a fly on the wall and had a window into her potential future. Sure, Thomas Capano would be a perfect prince in the beginning, but as soon as he had you hooked, he turned into a control freak and a mean one. In the late spring of 1994, several things happened that changed Anne Marie's living situation. She'd been sharing a place with two of her friends, but one of them was moving back to New Zealand and the other one was getting married that summer. So basically, in one foul swoop, Anne Marie had lost both her roommates, and now she needed to face the fact that it was going to be necessary to dip into her savings to find another place. But that money had been saved up for a trip to Ireland that summer that Anne Marie was taking with her younger brother, Brian. They wanted to go to Ireland and visit all the places that their grandmother had lived and walked and played during her childhood. And Anne Marie had also wanted to take a detour to Spain while she was in Europe. She'd been desperately wanting to return since spending a semester there in college. Once again, since Anne Marie talked about everything with Thomas Capano, she told him of her desire to visit Spain, but she also told him about her lack of funds to make it a possibility. Not long after this, an envelope arrived to her desk at work, and inside was a note that said, "Use this to go to Spain." And tucked in neatly next to the note were five crisp $100 bills. So Anne Marie did go to Ireland with her brother. She did not end up going to Spain, but it does appear that she kept the money. And when Anne Marie got back from Europe, she began renting the apartment on Washington Street, and she seemed at peace for the first time in a long time. She'd had an amazing time in Ireland. She really enjoyed getting in touch with her roots and escaping the hustle and bustle of Western capitalism. But although she seemed to be in a good place mentally, her friends began to notice how thin she was looking. Whenever she went out to lunch with her friend Jill, she would just order ice water. And when she went grocery shopping, she'd bring home some fruit, and that was about it. When Jill confronted Anne Marie with this, telling her, you know, I'm worried about you. I can't watch you kill yourself like this. Anne Marie responded, quote, don't worry about me. I'll stick around for a long time, end quote. And Anne Marie was becoming increasingly more dependent on two men in her life, her therapist, Bob Connors, who she had confessed feelings of inadequacy to. Anne Marie blamed herself for everything, and she beat herself up for her inability to assert herself with others because she had this desperate need to make sure that the people in her life were happy, but not only happy, happy with her. And she had a crippling fear that if she challenged them or set boundaries for herself, they would leave her. The second man that she was becoming dependent on was Thomas Capano, who she'd allowed herself to be vulnerable with. And as a result, he had a wide open look at all her bumps, her bruises, her scars, pressure points that he could use to make himself invaluable to her, to make sure that she needed him. But then, on January 24th, 1995, Anne Marie got a call from her trusted therapist, Bob Connors. They had been scheduled to meet that day for an appointment, but Bob had gotten an emergency call from another patient, and he had to rush out and see this patient, so he wanted to know if he could reschedule his appointment with Anne Marie. That night, Bob Connors was killed instantly when a drunk driver crossed the center line and crashed into his car head-on. Anne Marie blamed herself as she blamed herself for everything. She cried to her brother Brian that if she had only insisted that they keep their scheduled appointment, Bob might still be alive. Later, she wrote in her journal, quote, I loved Bob, and he has helped me grow so much, but we had a lot more work to do until I got to where I need to be at this point in my life. Bob was funny, intelligent, had a great smile, voice, and sense of humor. He believed in me and actually liked me for me. Not many people know the real Annie, end quote. That same month, Anne Marie's friends were planning to take her to dinner for her 29th birthday, but she was 30 minutes late meeting them because Tom Capano had dropped by her apartment with a 27-inch color TV that he had bought her for her birthday. She was stunned at this expensive gift, and when she told her friends about the TV at dinner, they were stunned too. They were like, that's kind of like an expensive, extravagant gift for a man who's married to give to, like, his friend. And all her friends, besides the very few who knew what was happening, would always say, like, you know, we think he likes you, or we think, you know, he wants something more than a friendship. And Anne Marie would always say, no, no, we are just very good friends. Now, Anne Marie would eventually start seeing another therapist named Gary Johnson, but she wasn't ready to move on to someone else so soon. So in the meantime, she confided in Tom Capano, and every new detail or secret she revealed added fuel to his fire and ammo to his arsenal. Anne Marie felt that they were getting closer, that their relationship was evolving. But then, the week of Valentine's Day, Tom told her during one of their conversations that he was throwing a party for their mutual friend, Bud Friel, Ed Friel's brother. Tom said that after the party, they were all getting together at O'Friel's pub, and naturally, Anne Marie took this as an invitation to also go to the party, even though the invitation was not explicitly given, because she didn't seem to really grasp the incredible secretive nature of their relationship. So she's thinking like a normal person, like, oh, my boyfriend is telling me about this party, and, you know, he's telling me where they're all going to be after and what time and et cetera, et cetera. That must mean that he would like me to show up there. Why else would he be telling her about it if he didn't want her to also attend, right? That's logic. But Tom Capano didn't really work with a ton of logic. He worked with his logic, but not normal people logic. When Anne Marie showed up at the bar, flanked by two of her friends, she spotted her secret boyfriend. She spotted him right away. He was at the bar, but then she got a little closer and she saw that he was standing next to his wife, Kay. And Tom and Kay were smiling at each other and they had their arms around each other. And then when Tom spotted Anne Marie, his face just contorted. It went from like this happy-go-lucky guy having fun at a bar to just like twisted, full of rage and disgust. And the whole situation felt like a punch to Anne Marie's stomach, so she immediately left. It bothered her to be in the same area as Tom, but not be able to be close to him. It bothered her to see him with his wife acting normally, not acting like somebody who hated his marriage and was so unhappy in his marriage. And it bothered her the way he had looked at her, like he wished she would just disappear off the face of the earth at that moment. That night, Anne Marie wrote in her journal, quote, "I was very sad and sick to my stomach. I am madly in love with him, and I did not truly realize just how deeply I felt until that night when I could not be near him. And then I realized that he is not and never will be mine." End quote. The next day, she wrote in her journal that she could not stop thinking about him and the look on his face when he had spotted her at the bar. She was hoping that he would call her, but he didn't. She wrote in her journal, quote, "I am so sorry, Tomas. I never wanted to hurt you or make you feel uncomfortable." End quote. Now remember that Debbie McIntyre, Tom's other secret lover, had mentioned a very similar state of constant apologeticness. She was always apologizing to Tom, even when she hadn't done anything that she felt she should be sorry for, because he was kind of like a god to these women. He could give love, but he could also take it away. He could become very cold and withholding. And when you've come to depend on someone for emotional support and acceptance and warmth, and they take it away, it can leave you feeling completely alone. Tom did not call Anne Marie for several days after giving her that disgusted look at O'Friel's pub. And this was a purposeful punishment, no doubt. And when Anne Marie finally did call Tom, he was cold and distant, and he rushed her off the phone. When she asked him what was wrong, he said nothing except everything, right? Everything in his life was wrong, and it sucked. And he was having a busy week, and then he hung up without saying goodbye. The next day, Anne Marie called his office and left a message, which he didn't return. And as the days passed with no word from him, no affirmation that they were still okay, Anne Marie began to feel crushed under the weight of anxiety, frustration, and confusion. And I'm sure that a lot of us have been in this situation before. Not this exact same situation, but you understand the way that she's feeling. While I was reading it, it reminded me so much of that FX show, Impeachment, about Bill Clinton and Monica Lewinsky. And it shows Monica Lewinsky, who's obviously like got this secret thing going on with the president of the United States. It shows her not even leaving her apartment because he might call. She would rush home from work. She would sit in her apartment by herself. Her friends would be like, "Let's go out to dinner. You know, let's do this. Let's go see a movie." And she'd be like, "I can't leave. He might call." And she would sit by her phone and drink wine. And every night he didn't call, she would cry herself to sleep and be so sad and upset. And every night he did call, it was like the sun came out again. And that's what you feel like in those situations. It's funny, actually, that I would bring up Bill Clinton because he actually becomes involved in Anne Marie Fahey's disappearance in a small capacity, but he does. After not hearing from Tom Capano for several days, Anne Marie wrote in her journal, quote, "What the F is going on? Why won't he talk to me? What did I do? God, please tell me what the F is going on. Tomas, please talk to me. I love you." End quote. Now, what was happening was a predator playing with his prey before devouring her. Anne Marie had laid herself bare. She'd been a complete open book with Thomas Capano, and thus he knew that she was terrified of rejection and abandonment. If Tom Capano had been a supportive and healthy partner, you know, even if he was cheating on his wife, even if he had been upset with her, even if he's clearly a scumbag because he's dating women on the side outside of his wife, you can still have a healthier, non-toxic love affair, healthier than this at least. So if he'd been a healthy and supportive partner, Tom could have communicated clearly what she had done to upset him. But he would also have reassured her that he still loved her, right? And one stupid little fight or mistake was not going to change that. It wasn't going to make or break them. Instead, he left her hanging, he stonewalled her, and he caused her to spiral into a dark hole of panic and anxiety where she would spend every minute picking herself apart, trying to figure out what she had done to make him so cold to her. And eventually, she would end up blaming herself and hating herself even more than she already did. It was truly diabolical. For a week, Tom left her twisting in the wind until he called to set up a meeting. Now, when they were together in person, Tom made a show of behaving like a man torn between his heart and his brain. He told Anne-Marie that he was so in love with her. He hadn't been avoiding her because he didn't love her. He'd been avoiding her because of how much he loved her. He also said that the thought of her being with someone else, it drove him to such anger and jealousy that it wasn't healthy. And he would become livid if he heard other men comment about her in a positive way. The two of them reconnected. They held each other in their arms and cried and clutched at each other. And Tom made sure that Anne-Marie could see the tears welling up in his eyes. And then he walked away, like he just couldn't do this anymore. He was hugging her and he's like, no, I can't do this. And he walked away and he said, I need to let you go for both of our sakes, right? And then he left, hot and cold, back and forth, on again, off again. That kind of emotional roller coaster is hard enough for anyone to live with for very long, much less someone like Anne-Marie, who was already struggling with a plethora of other issues and who had just lost her main support system, her therapist, Bob Connors, something that was really traumatic for her, something that Tom knew was really traumatic for her because she told him. That night, she wrote in her journal, quote, my life doesn't exist without Tomas. He deserves happiness. He does not deserve to be miserable. I'll wait forever. He is a wonderful, kind, caring, generous, sensitive man who deserves to be showered with the same kind of generosity he gives. I want to be that person. End quote. Thomas Capano liked beautiful things. He liked beautiful, fun things. And he collected women who fit this description like some men collect sports cars. But when Thomas Capano had something beautiful and fun that he valued, that he had paid a lot of money for, he didn't want anybody else putting their grubby paws on it. Thomas Capano wanted Anne-Marie Fahey all to himself. He wanted to isolate her from those who cared about her so that she would have only him to turn to depend on. And when that happened, he could do and say whatever he wanted to her. He could treat her however he wanted because she trusted him and because she had no one else to tell her that it was wrong. He had done the same thing to Debbie McIntyre. That wasn't the first night that he'd been verbally abusive with Debbie. When they were driving from Philadelphia to Wilmington, it wasn't the first time that he called her stupid or made her feel so small. He'd been doing that for years. And he would tell her sometimes, Debbie, you're a doormat at work. You let people walk all over you. And Debbie would say, yeah, I know, I got to do better. And Tom would say to her, yeah, I'm kind of treating you like a doormat. I treat you like a doormat all the time. I feel bad for that, but it's because you let me. It's not my fault. It's gaslighting to the extreme. Like I said, diabolical. So what Tom did was he made Anne-Marie feel that other people who are interested in her or who enjoyed her company, not only did it make him feel bad or sad, but it made him feel that it was stealing from him. Like all the time she spent with her friends or maybe even, potentially going out on dates or even her family was taking away from time that they could be together, even though he was never available because he had another girlfriend and a wife and four kids and a full-time job too. I mean, when does Tom Capano work? He hoped in doing this, in connecting all of her support systems, all of her friends and family with something that made him feel a negative way, that would make her feel guilty enough and it would make her take the initiative to be more available to him and less available to everyone else. And that's exactly what happened. In the spring of 1995, Anne-Marie became an unreliable friend. She would never be able to go out, or she'd make plans and cancel them, or make plans and then show up late. For St. Patrick's Day, she and her friend Jill Morrison had been planning to celebrate at O'Friel's. But when Jill was waiting for Anne-Marie to get ready to go out, the phone in Anne-Marie's apartment rang, and after a brief conversation, Anne-Marie walked into the living room, where Jill was reading a magazine on the couch, and she was like, you have to leave right now because Tom called. He's having a really hard time. He needs someone to talk to, and he's on his way here. Anne-Marie was like, go to O'Friel's. I'll meet you there later. Now, later, Jill asked what had been so important that Anne-Marie had to drop her plans to help Tom. And Anne-Marie claimed that Tom had been having a lot of problems in his marriage, and he just needed someone to talk to. Anne-Marie said, you know, he's always been there for me when I needed to talk. He's always been there for me. So how could I possibly say no? That's what he wanted her to feel, right? He wanted her to feel obligated. Obligated that even though she had a life and she had friends and she had plans, he needed her. Another time, Anne-Marie canceled plans because Tom had set her up with a job interview to become the personal assistant to his brother, Lewis. And this job interview came with like an apartment and all of that stuff. And we clearly see where this is going. And so did Anne-Marie, because after the interview, Anne-Marie met Jill for a drink. And at that point, she told Jill that she believed Tom Capano was trying to control her, because if she took the job with his brother, Tom would have a stranglehold on her life. He would know where she worked. He would know what she was doing all day. He would know where she lived. He'd be responsible for getting her that job. He'd be responsible for getting her that apartment. She would just owe him. There's starting to be a lot of red in her ledger. Now, on one hand, Anne-Marie was smart enough to see the writing on the wall. But she also felt that Tom was so miserable and sad in his life that he was trying to exert his will on the one thing that was good in his life because he didn't want to lose her. And that was something she could understand. So when Tom started telling her how to dress, she wrote it off as deep love and nothing more nefarious. One day he saw her wearing like a tight red skirt to work, and he commented that it made her look like a whore. He said, no one's ever going to take you seriously dressed like that. You keep saying you want a raise. You keep saying like you want to go forward in your career, but then you show up looking like this and you're sending the opposite message. It's embarrassing. Once again, this comment would have been harsh for anyone to hear. But for someone like Anne-Marie, who struggled under the weight of her negative body image, it was a crushing blow. One meant to keep her in check, to keep her in a constant state of low self-esteem. Anne-Marie hated her legs more than any other part on her body, right? She had body dysmorphia in general. She thought she was overweight, even though she wasn't. She was taking laxatives and working out and starving herself specifically to lose weight. But the one thing that never changed was how much she hated her legs. So it really bothers me to think about the strength that it took her to summon up the courage to put that skirt on, knowing how much she hated her legs, and walk outside of the house only to be shot down by the one person that she trusted and was vulnerable with. It must have been the nail in the coffin, you know, the final nail in the coffin as to how she felt about her legs. It was almost as if Tom Capano had planned out every single step of the destruction of Anne-Marie's self-worth. So after Tom had iced Anne-Marie out for a week, he called her and he asked her an odd question. He asked her what she would do with her last day on Earth. Anne-Marie answered honestly. She told him that she would like to play hooky from work. She would like to stay in her apartment with him all day long. They would make marinara sauce together, and they would make love while it simmered on the stove. And then they'd watch all their favorite movies together and all the movies they'd talked about wanting to see together. Like I said, for her, this was an honest and genuine answer, a vulnerable answer, an answer that took him into consideration. But his response shocked her. He screamed at her that he didn't believe a word she said, and then he slammed the phone down. She wrote in her journal that she had been holding back some from him. She hadn't told him everything about herself, but if he gave her another chance, she would reveal everything to him. It was as if he had made her believe that protecting herself, not letting herself be vulnerable around him completely, meant that she didn't love him enough. It would only be after she had given over herself to him 100% that she could prove she was in it for the long haul. That summer, Anne-Marie and her friends began making plans to spend weekends at the shore again, as they did every summer, even after she'd become involved with Tom Capano. There was no reason that Anne-Marie should have felt that this year would be any different, but it was, because this season, the girls had decided to combine forces with some of the male employees of the governor's office because they wanted to get a bigger house and it was more expensive. And when Anne-Marie found out that there would be men staying in the house with her that summer, she told her best friend, Kim Horstman, she did not think Tom would be happy with her staying in such close quarters with other men. Anne-Marie agreed to go ahead with the plans anyway because she'd already put the deposit down, she was kind of already locked in, and she'd made promises to her friends. But according to Kim, it was a horrible summer. Instead of going every weekend, Anne-Marie made excuses of why she couldn't. And when she was there, she was upset because she was fighting with Tom about it. He would show up at her apartment when he knew that she was going to be packing and leaving for the shore. And then he would rage at her for hours to the point where she was too exhausted to do anything or see anyone. And if she did make it to the shore, she was just stressed out and sad all weekend because he was withholding again. He was like, fine, go, but you're not going to hear from me. And then he'd hang up on her. And then she'd just wonder, like, how long is it going to take for me to make this up to him again? How many times do I have to say I'm sorry now when I get back to Wilmington before he talks to me again? Tom told Anne-Marie that he didn't understand why she felt the need to have all these friends. You know, she's a grown woman, and didn't he give her everything she needed? Wasn't he enough for her? If he wasn't enough for her, she clearly didn't love him as much as he loved her. Never mind that he was married. Never mind that when they weren't together, Tom went home to a house full of people who loved him, while Anne-Marie sat in an empty apartment and cried over him. Author Anne Rule said it perfectly in her book about this case called And Never Let Her Go. She wrote, quote, Tom kept Anne-Marie continually off balance. When he was pleased with her, he listened sympathetically as she spoke of her fears and insecurities, and he told her how wonderful she was. He offered her a world without anxieties, but when she displeased him, he could be as cold as death, end quote. This is a little triggering for me, because I've been in a relationship like this before. It is torture. It is mental torture, it's emotional torture, and it turns physical because you're just so exhausted, you're so stressed, you're so sad, you're crying all the time, your head hurts because you're crying so much. You don't wanna talk to anybody, you don't wanna see anybody because this is all you can think of. You're just waiting for your person who you love and who you think loves you to reach out to you again and tell you that it's okay. And then you'll feel better, and then you'll feel relief and peace for the first time in however long he's been torturing you. It's really bad, and it makes me feel incredibly sad for her. And I always considered myself smart enough to know that when I was being talked down to, it wasn't something that was true. I knew that he was trying to hurt me, but even though you're smart, and even though you kind of know what's happening, it doesn't stop it from hurting. It doesn't stop it from being so hard. It's a very strange situation. Some people really do have this need to manipulate somebody else and then own them body, soul, and mind. And it's so dangerous and scary. But while Tom Capano was talking to Anne-Marie about her friends and her friendships, he was also trying to get on the good side of those who were close to her. In the summer of 1995, he began to help Anne-Marie's friend and former roommate, Jackie Bernersley, start her own business. Jackie had told Anne-Marie that she wanted to open a coffee shop in downtown Wilmington, but she didn't know where to start. So Tom suggested that he and Anne-Marie meet her for lunch, and over sandwiches, he told Jackie to not worry about a thing. He would take care of all the paperwork to get her incorporated, and he gave her advice on things like equipment, taxes, menu items, catering possibilities, all free of charge. When Jackie's coffee shop opened in August, Tom Capano insisted that he be the first customer of Java Jack's. And he also gave Jackie's shop tons of catering business from his law firm, which is very close to the coffee shop, and other law firms in the area that were also close because everything was kind of centrally located downtown. Every morning before going to work, Tom would visit Jackie at the coffee shop. He would get some coffee, and then he would kiss her on the mouth before saying goodbye and walking out. And she was a bit creeped out by this close physical contact, which she had not asked for. But she reminded herself how much of a help he had been, and she let it slide. Like I said, Tom Capano is pretty much Andrew Cuomo. Tom had also stepped in to help Anne-Marie's friend Jill when she was having trouble with her landlord, once again free of charge. And when Anne-Marie's sister Kathleen gave birth to her son, he sent a basket of fruit to the hospital, which Kathleen was obviously appreciative of, but she didn't really understand why a man who was virtually a stranger to her had made such a nice gesture. Now, around this time, Anne-Marie finally decided it had been long enough, and she began seeing a psychologist, Gary Johnson, once a week on Tuesday afternoons. She didn't go into specifics about Tom Capano with Gary at first. She didn't trust him enough for that yet, but she did say she'd started to notice a pattern with the older man that she was dating. He did so many nice things for her. He was so generous and kind, but in exchange for being with him, in exchange for the nice things that he was doing for her, She felt she had lost a great deal of her freedom, and she also felt she was always walking on eggshells. Tom Capano didn't know it, but Anne-Marie had started to really wrestle with her feelings for him, and she was beginning to second-guess whether or not they should remain in each other's lives at all. So when Tom invited Anne-Marie to spend 4 days with him at the Homestead Luxury Resort in the Allegheny Mountains of Virginia, she reluctantly agreed. Maybe Anne-Marie was thinking that 4 days alone together would give her the answers she needed. They would show her whether what she had been feeling for Tom was real or just part of the excitement of being involved in a secret love affair. For 4 days, they relaxed, they read together, they cuddled, made love, went horseback riding during the day and dancing and dining at night. And Tom came away from that Virginia trip feeling that he had lived through 4 days of bliss. But according to Kim Horstman, Anne-Marie later told her it had been a complete disaster. They'd argued for the majority of the trip. On the five-hour drive back to Wilmington from Virginia, Anne-Marie began to write a list of the things that she and Tom shared in common and the things that they did not. She called it the Coke Pepsi list. This list illustrated just how different they were on things both fundamental and not all that important. Tom preferred Coke, whereas Anne-Marie preferred Pepsi, which is obviously the superior cola. Tom loved food, while Anne-Marie wrote down that she was anorexic. He was Italian, she was Irish. He wasn't into cars, and she was. He considered himself a conservative, whereas she considered herself to be very liberal. He was an academic, but she did not consider herself to be one. He was observant, she was spacey. He was not a morning person, but she was. He liked to stay at home, and she liked to travel. Tom was always very serious, but Anne-Marie rarely was. He liked red meat. She was a vegetarian. He loved history. She found it boring. She hated cigarettes. Tom Capano was a smoker. Later, Tom would comment on this list, saying, quote, "She wrote that I had a double standard, and that she did not have two standards. I do have a double standard. I think there are things men should do and women shouldn't. It's that simple." End quote. All right, Don Draper. How the turntables have turned. You know, there's things that men should do that women shouldn't, like having multiple affairs, right, Tom? The list of things that they had in common, though, was quite short. They both liked bread from DeFanzo's. They both liked Frank Sinatra, NPR, pasta, Italian food, reading, the finer things in life, politics, wine, and children. Now, obviously, liking pasta and Frank Sinatra does not a long-lasting relationship make. Although that bread thing, that can tie you together forever. Shortly after returning to Wilmington, Tom Capano told Anne-Marie something that shocked her and upped her anxiety. He said he was finally ready to leave his wife, Kay. Anne-Marie told him that he needed to do what he wanted to do, but she was also clear when she told him she didn't want him breaking up his family for her. If he made that decision, he needed to do it, understanding that it was for him and him alone, and she would not be a factor at all. I think this was a little naive, but I think that she tried. I think she tried, you know? But I think at this point, it was a little naive to think that he would make any decision about whether he stayed married or not without factoring her in. But I'm sure Tom was expecting a much more excited reaction, right? Because Anne-Marie, for the majority of the time they'd been together, had sort of wanted to be with him full-time, to be with him in a real capacity. But now she just didn't seem excited about it. And you know, usually when a man tells his girlfriend, his secret lover, that he's gonna leave his wife to be with her, he's full of shit. But Tom Capano's words were not empty. And at the end of August, he gathered his wife and four daughters for dinner, and he told them that he'd been very unhappy for a long time, and he was gonna be moving out of their family home for a while. He assured them that his feelings, they had nothing to do with anything that his wife or daughters had done. And when his wife Kay asked him if there was someone else, he vehemently denied it. The Capano family was stunned. I mean, everybody was stunned. There had been no warning of this. Everyone had thought that Tom knew he lived a beautiful life, a blessed life that he should have been grateful for. Tom moved in with his brother Lewis for a while he looked for a place to rent. And he also told his longtime girlfriend, Debbie McIntyre, that they could now be together for real and get married, but she needed to be patient and wait long enough so that Kay wouldn't think he had left her for someone else. But stringing both Anne-Marie and Debbie McIntyre along was not enough for Tom. the man for whom enough is never enough. He was also seeing a 32-year-old legal secretary named Susan Louth. Their favorite things to do together were to go out to dinner at expensive restaurants and lay around her living room watching mobster movies. Tom loved mobster movies, especially Goodfellas. But just as Tom Capano was becoming freed up, at least from his marriage, Anne Marie was finding herself being set up with a young, handsome banker from Rhode Island. With Mike Scanlon, Anne Marie got an inside look into what a real relationship was. A relationship built on mutual respect, shared values, and friendship. And it looked completely different than what she had been experiencing with Tom Capano. By mid-October of 1995, Anne Marie was feeling very positive about her new relationship, and she was pulling away from Tom more and more. Tom had moved out of his brother's mansion, and he was renting a two-story brick home located at 2303 North Grant Avenue, less than a five-minute drive from Anne Marie's apartment. But he didn't have to be living so close to her to find out that Anne Marie Fahey and Michael Scanlon were the new hot couple in town. It was Wilmington, after all, where rumors and news spread as quickly and as easily as dust in the wind. Tom was absolutely beside himself when he found out that his secret girlfriend had been keeping a secret from him, and he confronted her about her new relationship. Anne Marie no longer thought night and day about Tomas. She no longer longed to be with him, living her life beside him, but she was still afraid of displeasing him. Old habits die hard. So Anne Marie told Tom that she was seeing Mike, but she lied and she said it wasn't serious, even though she had told her friends and family that she thought Mike could be the one. Tom began to increase his efforts of shame and pressure. He called her every day multiple times, sometimes up to 25 times a day. He sent her emails at work demanding that she break up with Mike because he had left his wife for her after all. He said he could not live without her and he threatened to hurt himself if she wouldn't see him. When threats didn't work, he tried bribes. Tom told Anne Marie he would give her better presents, like a Lexus, the car she had always longed to own. He painted her a picture of the future they could have together, where she would never have to worry about money. They could get married and live in a mansion together. Every carrot he dangled in front of her, Anne Marie politely declined. From there, Tom's behavior turned from desperate to creepy. He began driving by her apartment so often that she could look out her window at any given time and see his Jeep, like, creeping by or parked somewhere. He would park outside her apartment for hours sometimes, and if she was at Mike's house, he parked outside of Mike's house. When that didn't work, he started taking his daughters to Sunday Mass at the same church that Anne Marie attended. When she changed her Mass time to avoid him, so did Tom, and he told her that he had informed the priest at their church about their relationship, and it wasn't going to be long before he told the entire congregation about their affair. She was so humiliated that she ended up having to switch churches. He began calling her friends and digging for information about Anne Marie. Had they seen her? Where was she? How was she? One of the members of Governor Carper's security team, Siobhan Sullivan, had become close friends with Anne Marie during their time working together, and she had been introduced to Tom Capano during a function at the governor's mansion. Anne Marie had never told Siobhan directly that she and Tom were involved, but Siobhan had noticed how often Tom called Anne Marie and how often he stopped by to visit her at work, and she'd sort of put two and two together. She suspected, but it wasn't confirmed. When Anne Marie started putting distance between herself and her older secret boyfriend, Siobhan was suddenly inundated with calls from Tom Capano asking her to go out and grab a drink with him, talk about basketball, because I guess Siobhan coached basketball, Tom's daughters played basketball, so he kind of made, like, stupid cover-up reasons of why he wanted to get together. But she felt a bit awkward about doing this, so she made excuses as to why she couldn't. One night he called her and asked if she had talked to Anne Marie, adding that Anne Marie was really mad at him, that he was feeling quite lonely after leaving his wife. Siobhan told him to just give Anne Marie some space, and later she told her friend that Tom had been asking about her, to which Anne Marie responded angrily, quote, "He is a possessive, controlling maniac. I am getting tired of him," end quote. And before Siobhan could respond, Anne Marie turned and just basically stormed out of the office. As fall turned into winter, Anne Marie and Mike Scanlon were making huge strides towards the future. He had met her family, and she had met his family. They'd gone on many public dates together. Mike didn't force her to go to a different state. to have dinner in order to hide their relationship. She wasn't sitting on the back burner waiting for him to give her the time of day. And the more that Anne-Marie was seen with Mike, the more Tom spewed insults and vitriol towards the man he perceived to be his romantic rival and inferior to him in every way. He told Anne-Marie that he didn't know what she saw in Mike. Mike was boring, the safe choice, and maybe he needed to know all of her dirty little secrets because someone as straight-laced as Mike Scanlon would probably be disgusted to know that Anne-Marie had been responsible for breaking up a family and a marriage. Tom also threatened to tell Mike about Anne-Marie's eating disorder, something she had kept hidden from almost everyone she knew. Mike had asked her why she'd been losing so much weight, and she'd lied, saying that the doctors couldn't figure it out. She didn't want this shiny new relationship soiled by her issues. She wanted him to see her as happy, healthy, and normal. She was trying to get better, but she didn't want to bring her shit into this new relationship. Although, I will say, Mike Scanlon, as straight-laced and, you know, proper as he was, he loved her so much, he would have been fine with it. He would have helped her, and he would have supported her. Now, Mike Scanlon left Delaware on December 23rd to spend Christmas in Rhode Island with his family, but he promised Anne-Marie he would be back before New Year's. Tom Capano took advantage of his absence to try and tempt Anne-Marie with something he knew she wanted very badly, a trip to Spain. Tom called her and he said, you know, I bought the tickets and I'm going to be with you and I'm going to arrange everything for our magical trip together. I'm going to figure out where we're going to stay, where we're going to go. I've got this all. You don't worry about a thing. But when Anne-Marie firmly turned down this generous gift, he flew into a rage. He stormed into her apartment. He physically grabbed her and pushed her into the wall, growling into her face that if she wanted to be ungrateful, he was just going to take everything back that he had ever given her. She responded, fine, take it back. I don't want it. If you want your shit back, take it and get out. So Tom, like a damn fool, ran around her apartment, gathering up all the clothes he had given her and unplugging the television in her bedroom as he told her that he would be damned if she watched that TV with any other man beside him. He even took a bottle of salad dressing out of her refrigerator. And then he stormed out of the apartment. Within 15 minutes, he was back and apologizing, and he sheepishly replaced all the items he had removed. But not long after this, Tom begged Anne-Marie to sit in his car with him and talk things out. They began to argue in the car, and he reverted to his favorite insults, calling her a slut and a whore and a redneck and worthless. And when she reached for the door handle to get out, he locked the doors and he grabbed her, wrapping his hands around her neck. Anne-Marie was able to escape, but the interaction obviously had left her shaken and afraid of the man that she had once told her journal she loved so much. The weird thing was, though, after each of these violent and unhinged outbursts, Tom would email or call Anne-Marie the next day as if nothing had happened, and Anne-Marie began to feel as if she was going crazy. He would go back and forth between being the most generous man, the most supportive, listening ear, to calling her names and telling her that she was white trash. She was white trash, and white trash like herself should be thanking her lucky stars every day to even have a chance to be with someone like him. One day at the end of December, Tom walked into Jackie's coffee shop, and she said she was surprised by how terrible he looked. He was pale. He was gaunt. He had dark circles around his eyes like he hadn't slept in days. She said he looked as if he had lost a ton of weight, and in general, she thought that he seemed to just be very sad and depressed. Tom told a concerned Jackie that he was having a really hard time facing his first Christmas without his children, and he was considering ending his own life. And Jackie was like, holy shit, like, this is serious. You know, don't do that. Like, nothing's that bad. You're going to figure it out. But no matter what Jackie said or how she tried to help, Tom remained in this very sad state whenever he saw her. And before he left, Tom wondered if Jackie would be interested in getting dinner with himself and Anne-Marie, because he could really use some friends right now. Jackie obviously felt bad for Tom, so she approached Anne-Marie and told her, like, listen, Tom's in a really bad place. Like, he's not doing well. He wants to get together. I think we should. And Anne-Marie told Jackie, Tom's fine. You know, like, don't worry about Tom. But after Jackie brought it up several times, prompted by several more sad puppy-faced visits from Tom, Anne-Marie finally and reluctantly relented. So apparently Jill and Anne-Marie met Tom at his new house that he was renting, and he like made them come in so he could give them a tour. And he was like, look, all of my daughters have bedrooms. They're already decorated. Like, look at this great living room, this huge TV. We can watch movies later if we want. You know, this is my house. And the women were like, oh, nice, nice. You know, it was just kind of odd. And then they went to dinner, a dinner that took place at La Familia in Philadelphia. During the dinner, Anne-Marie was cordial, but quiet. It seemed like she definitely didn't want to be there. And when she got up to use the bathroom, Tom looked mournfully at Jackie, and he asked her why Anne-Marie hated him so much. In truth, Anne-Marie did not hate Tom Capano. There was still a part of her that loved him, even if it was not a romantic love. And she still didn't have a desire to see him sad or hurt. Her plan was to be able to communicate with him in a kind and gentle way that she valued him as a person, as a friend, and she wanted to continue their friendship, but a romantic relationship wasn't going to benefit either one of them. She hoped she could make this transition by putting some space between them, right? Not making herself as available to him and avoiding seeing him in person as much as possible. He would send her emails all day, every day. Conversational and casual topics for the most part. Like one time he said, you know, did you see NYPD Blue last night? Great show. Or one time he said he had tried the Old Bay French fries from DiNardo's and they were amazing. He talks about his daughters and his daughter's basketball games. But he would often end the emails with, I love you, or ti amo. One night in mid-January, he showed up at her apartment unannounced. And this was a sign to Anne-Marie that she hadn't been clear enough about her intentions. Apparently, Tom tried to make a move on her, like a sexy sex move. And the next morning, Tom Capano received an email from Anne-Marie that said, quote, good morning, Tommy. I want to apologize for my outbreak last night. I am sure it must have scared you. Quite honestly, I scared myself last night, Tommy. I had a lot on my mind last night regarding my appointment with Gary Johnson. Right now, I need a friend more than anything else. There was a part of me that just wanted to be alone to think things out clearly. So when I asked you not to rub my stomach and you responded with how much I hurt you, I couldn't take feeling guilty about that with everything else that I am feeling. It is my fault because I was not communicating with you and you didn't know how to respond. I am sorry for my behavior. Please try to understand that right now I have some things to work out, but I'm not sure where to start. End quote. So we don't know for sure what happened between Tom and Anne-Marie the night before she sent this email. But in my opinion, I think he showed up unannounced. She was probably like, come in. You know, you're here anyways. They sat down. Maybe they were watching TV. And he, you know, started like pulling up her shirt, trying to touch her stomach. You know how guys get sometimes when they're like all casually trying to like get your pants off. And she probably reacted, you know, very like strongly. Because at that point, she was in love with Mike, her boyfriend. And she was not in romantic love with Tom Capano anymore. So probably when he touched her, she kind of like cringed and she was like, oh God, why? Freaking keep telling this guy, you just want to be friends. And he's like pushing it. He's touching me. And she was probably like, please don't touch me. She probably snapped, you know. And that's why she said she scared herself, because I think she probably reacted a little more intensely than she had planned to. And then he's guilt tripping her like, oh, you hurt my feelings when you yelled at me. Like, yo, dude, I know you're a murderer. Okay, I get it. Like, I shouldn't expect any sort of moral fiber from you. But for everybody out there, don't you ever let anybody, man or woman, make you feel guilty that you asked not to be touched. That is some bullshit. I'm going to say it right now. Put your foot down. Don't you ever. And she's over here apologizing to him, you know, because she's always apologizing to him. Just like Debbie McIntyre is always apologizing to him because they don't want his wrath. They don't want him to make it awkward. They don't want him to punish them. Later that month, Anne-Marie's sister Kathleen was planning a surprise 30th birthday party for Anne-Marie that was scheduled for January 27th. Now, Anne-Marie, she found out about the party. You know, it wasn't a huge surprise, but she was terrified that Tom Capano was going to be on the guest list. So she went to great lengths to make sure that he was not invited. She said that she was actually terrified for her life that he might be there. And she was constantly scared that Tom and Mike would run into each other and Tom would be unable to restrain himself. She was always worried every time her and Mike came home from a date that Tom Capano was going to be waiting outside her apartment and then he would like confront Mike and be like, oh, by the way, your girlfriend, you know, she's been with me for the last 2 years and blah, 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 blah. But Tom was not at the birthday party, and Mike, who wasn't supposed to be at the birthday party because he was traveling for work, he flew back and surprised her. and she was so happy. She had the best time. And the next night, Anne-Marie donned a floor-length sequined ball gown, and feeling like a princess, she excitedly got all dolled up to attend Wilmington's Grand Gala Ball on the arm of Mike Scanlon, where they would drink expensive champagne while rubbing elbows with Delaware's elite. Anne-Marie's friend Jill stopped over to help Anne-Marie get ready because everyone knew that Anne-Marie was super excited about this night. Like, she was really pumped. But when Jill got there, she said Anne-Marie's excitement at the prospect of the evening had dissolved into tears. Anne-Marie said that Tom had found out she was going to the gala with Mike, and he'd been calling all day. She said he always did this, and he was psychotic. While Jill was in Anne-Marie's apartment, the phone rang six more times. All six times, it was Tom on the phone threatening one thing after the other. He told Anne-Marie that he was going to get a date and attend the gala as well, determined to make her evening a miserable one. He mentioned that maybe she should be worried that he would find her boyfriend and tell him what a slut Anne-Marie was. Luckily, Tom Capano did not show up at the gala that night, maybe because he couldn't find a date since he'd creeped out every woman in Delaware. Or maybe, you know, he didn't have the balls, because by that point, you know, he had enough balls to drop threats left and right, but not enough to actually follow through on them at that point. Anne-Marie would later tell her friends that the evening at the gala, dressed to the nines on the arm of the man she loved, it had been the best night of her life. Many of Mike's friends had asked him, you know, why didn't you tell us your new girlfriend was a model? And Anne-Marie truly felt beautiful for the first time in a long time. That night, she and Mike decided that they would be exclusive. But when she got home that night and took off her sparkling dress and was faced with the quiet of her apartment, Anne-Marie began to worry that she might have hurt Tom Capano. He had hurt her often, but she could not accept the fact that he was a bad person. She thought he had lashed out at her because of his own hurt. You know, hurt people hurt people. And Anne-Marie was an incredibly kind woman. Once she cared about someone, she always cared about that person. And she knew that just because someone did something bad, it didn't make them a bad person. She was also very appreciative for all the many times Tom had been there for her, the way he gave to her so freely of his time, of his money, the way he seemed to genuinely want her to be happy and healthy. So when she got to work on Monday morning, she sat down at her computer and wrote him an email that read, quote, "First, let me start off by saying that I am sorry for the pain that I have caused you over the weekend. I am afraid I do not know where to begin. I spent a good part of yesterday morning and afternoon at Valley Garden Park thinking about a lot of stuff. Us, girls, eating disorder, my family, etc. I desperately want to talk to you, but I'm too afraid to place the call. I do love you, Tommy. No matter what happens, I will always love you." End quote. In her mind, right, after the let's just be friends conversation they'd had not long before, Anne-Marie felt that telling Tom she loved him, he would understand that she meant that she loved him as a person, as a friend. But to Tom Capano, a man driven mad by his obsession to possess and control her, the words "I love you" were a beacon of hope. He hoped that his gaslighting and his mind games had finally brought Anne-Marie back under his spell, because he didn't think very highly of her at all, right? He thought she was weak. He thought she had all of these mental health issues, and it was kind of like by her own design. Like, he did not respect her, you can tell. He didn't want her to get better from her issues. He wanted them to get worse, because the worse they were, the more vulnerable she was. So he wrote Anne-Marie an email back saying, quote, "I desperately want to talk to you too, and I'll go out of my mind if I don't soon. Please don't be afraid to place the call. I need to hear your voice. I'm leaving now for a meeting. Please call me. Not hearing from you since Saturday afternoon is making me crazy, and you know how much I love you and need you. I'll wait for your call. Ti amo." End quote. So the two corresponded back and forth for a few days, casually, with Tom consistently trying to make plans where they could see each other in person, and Anne-Marie making excuses about why she could not. But on February 7th, Anne-Marie wrote, quote, "I know we were supposed to get together the last two weekends, and things have come up. Tommy, I meant what I said on Sunday night about right now only being able to offer you my friendship. And if you cannot deal with that, then I understand. I'm still very much confused, and I'm trying to work out a lot of personal things on my own." End quote. So I think this is a very direct sentiment, right? I can only give you friendship, period. Like, it's hard to, you know, interpret that any other way than how it was said. And I think at this point, Tom realized that his hold on her was very tenuous, and the only shot he had at manipulating her again was to pretend to play along, pretend to be the nice guy she had fallen in love with, and hopefully lull her into a false sense of security to the point where she would become dependent on him once again. He responded with his own email saying, quote, "Good morning, Annie. Thank you for the email. Yesterday was very harsh. Divorce meetings with attorneys, and I am not sure how to react. I would like to talk to you about it. I'd like to have dinner with you on Saturday night. I need to talk to you about work, and I think you need to talk about Gary Johnson, etc. I understand that you're confused and want to limit our relationship now to friendship. I love you enough to accept that and ask only that we treat each other kindly and honestly. I don't want to lose you. I also think we shouldn't lose the closeness we've developed. If nothing else, you know you can tell me your fears and hopes and rely on me to support you. I still want to be there for you, which I guess is the surest sign that I still love you with all my heart. You cannot do all of this on your own, Annie. No one can. Let me help. Please call me when it's convenient. I'd like to know about Saturday. You look like you could use a good meal, and I have to admit, I've always fed you well. Ti amo." End quote. Ugh, he's so gross, man. So gross. The message is clear, to me at least. I can still be your person. Talk to me about all your hopes and fears, all your insecurities and flaws. Give me more ammo that I can use against you, and don't forget that I've always been this person for you. You're weak. You're too weak to do this on your own. You need me because I'm strong and you're weak. I've always been there for you. I've always been your sounding board, your safe space, your shoulder to cry on. Don't forget all I've done for you. The gifts, the money, the clothes, the fancy dinners, and all the other things my money can buy you. Also, don't forget that you're plagued by an eating disorder. How could you forget? I'm going to find a little sly passive-aggressive way to remind you because I know you're self-conscious about your body and about your condition, and I have to make sure that you stay that way. You know, abuse doesn't always come in the form of mean words, insults. It can come in the form of being nice, being so nice, being overly nice. It's a way that people like Tom Capano make sure that you think they are your greatest friend when in fact they are a huge threat to you. But if you knew they were a huge threat to you, you wouldn't let them close. But if you think they're your best friend, if you think that they love you and they care about you and they would do anything for you, you let them close, not knowing that you've let a fox into the hen house. For all of you out there who are currently dating or, you know, want to date, keep that in mind. Keep it in mind. Tom Capano may have been playing along, hoping to lure Anne-Marie back into his clutches, but it appears he was also busy developing a plan B. Not long after this email exchange, Tom approached his younger brother, Jerry, and asked to borrow $8,000. When Jerry asked what he needed the money for, Tom responded that he was being extorted by a couple, a man and a woman. These people were threatening his family and his daughters. He'd been paying them off for a while, but they always wanted more. So Jerry removed the money from his trust fund, and he gave it to Tom with no other questions because Tom was the golden boy, the one who fixed everyone else's problems, and now he was just trying to fix one of his own. On February 9th, Tom paid Jerry back with a check, and he told him that if anyone asked what the check had been for, he should say that it was for landscaping that Jerry had done at Tom's house. That weekend, Tom called Anne-Marie several times, trying to arrange a dinner date, and she also spotted him driving by her house on a few different occasions between calls. On Monday, February 12th, Anne-Marie sent an email to Tom Capano saying, quote, "Tommy, you scared me this weekend, starting with Friday and all the calls you placed. It really freaks me out when you call every half hour. I truly understand how fragile you are these days, and I feel the same way. But when you keep calling that way, it makes me turn the other way and, quite frankly, shut down. I'm sorry that I'm nothing but a constant disappointment to you these days. It's not fair to you. I have an idea of what I need to do. I just cannot bring myself to start the process. I apologize for being such a horrible person to you. You are the last person on this earth I want to hurt. Did you have dinner on 17th Street last night? I thought I saw your Jeep parked in front of the white Benz out in front of the house last night when I was coming home. Anyway, I know we have to talk today, but I wanted to start off with this email." End quote. She's like, "You called me a lot." And then she's like, "Were you having dinner on 17th Street?" She knew he wasn't having dinner. She knew. She was just hoping against hope that this dude was there having dinner and not stalking her. 2 days later on Valentine's Day, Anne-Marie received two flower deliveries, two beautiful arrangements of long-stemmed red roses that were placed on her desk. One was sent by her boyfriend, Mike Scanlon. The other had been sent by Tom Capano. Anne-Marie's office mates watched in shock as she picked up the second arrangement and dropped them in her garbage can before walking away. At the end of February of 1996, Tom Capano went to his little brother Jerry for help again. This time he said he needed a gun for protection against the people who were extorting him. He told Jerry that these extortionists were crazy, and if they tried to hurt his family, he would kill them. Jerry felt this was understandable, and he led his brother into the spare bedroom of his mansion, where he revealed a large gun safe with a varied selection of firearms. And he opened it up, and like Iron Man, he was like, choose one. You know, which Iron Man suit are you going to wear today? Tom quickly chose a handgun, and Jerry, who knew that his brother didn't know anything about guns, much less how to, like, fire one safely, he suggested that Tom go with a shotgun. A shotgun was better for home protection, but Tom insisted on a handgun, so Jerry gave in and allowed him to take a 10mm Colt revolver from the safe. After this, Tom again mentioned to Jerry how he might have to take care of the extortionists, and he wondered if Jerry would let him borrow his boat, a 25-foot Hydra Sport. Tom said if he needed to kill this man and woman, he would need the boat to get rid of their bodies. Within 4 months, Anne-Marie Fahey would vanish, presumed dead, disposed of at the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean. And that is where we will end today's video episode, part two of Anne-Marie's case. It's a crazy case. There's so much more, so stay tuned. I know some of you don't like multi-parters, but there are certain cases that really need to be told. There are certain cases that we need to remember the victim and who she was, and what brought her to where she ended up being. And we have to understand that this could happen to any one of us, right? Anne-Marie was just like me, was just like, you know, you. She worked, she was broke half the time, she wanted things she couldn't afford, she had some trauma in her past, but she had a loving set of friends and siblings who were there for her. And because of the trauma in her past, because of these insatiable needs she had inside of her to be loved and cared for, she ended up falling for the wrong person, and any one of us could have done it. And honestly, you know, she probably didn't even realize half the time that what Tom was doing was bad and toxic. And I blame, like, the 50 Shades of Grey effect for this. That's the 50 Shades of Grey / Twilight effect, you know? Like, you know, we'll go with Twilight. Edward and Bella. Edward, everyone thought he was so romantic. Team Edward. Personally, me, I'm not Team Edward or Team Jacob, because they both had some issues, and they both were, like, super, like, uber aggressive and possessive of Bella, and I didn't really think that that was necessary at all. But Edward, always, you know, hovering over Bella, watching her at night, sneaking into her freaking bedroom and watching her at night while she's sleeping, following her around when she goes on dates with her friends. Like, I don't mean dates. I mean, like, she's going to dinner with her friends, her girlfriends, and he's following her to make sure nothing happens to her. He buys her an expensive car. He doesn't ever want her to do anything where she could potentially get hurt. He's gonna hole her up in this big glass house of opulence and wealth and let her drive these expensive cars, but she's never gonna leave his sight because she's his, and he doesn't want anything to happen to her. And some women look at that and they think it's romantic. He loves me so much, like, he goes out of his way to protect me. He goes out of his way to make sure that I'm never going to be in an unsafe position. He tells me what to dress because he loves me so much, because he doesn't want other people to judge me. He stalks me because he wants to make sure that he's not losing me. This is so romantic. It's not. It's controlling. It's toxic, and it's controlling, and it's not romantic. What's romantic is having a partner who trusts you enough to let you out of his sight. Okay, that's freaking romantic. But anyways, that is where we will end today. Thank you so much for being here. Hit the like button if you liked the video. Subscribe if you haven't already, because YouTube's unsubscribing people all the time from my channel. They're such control freaks, man. I mean, man, they're always trying to isolate me from you guys, so all I have is them. But make sure you're subscribed. Make sure you share the video if you think it's worth sharing. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram, and follow my podcast, Crime Weekly, that I host every week with retired police detective Derek Levasseur. New episodes come out wherever you get your podcasts on Fridays, and then the following Wednesday, we put the video version of that episode up on our YouTube channel. Everything's linked in the description box. And don't forget to check out Surfshark. Get yourself protected online. The link is also in the description box. Thank you guys so much for being here. Stay kind, stay beautiful, stay safe, and I'll see you very soon. Bye. Hi. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you, baby. Oh, look at me. Come over here.
I haven't even done my hair yet.
It's so cute. He just got a haircut. Bend down and look at the people. Isn't it cute?
Oh my God. Oh my God. It's not even done.
It's so cute. You look so cute. I love you. Thank you for the coffee, baby.
You're welcome.
Straight down, and that river runs deep. The mountains get steep, and the voices getting too loud. All these feelings I've buried, it's looking like a cemetery. They're going back from the grave, calling out my name. Better say a Hail Mary. Well, you don't know how deep it goes until it's getting you slowly. So you got to let it go. I got blood.